பேக். இப்போது நான் கலாநிதி ஜெயம்பதி விக்ரமரத்ன அவர்களுடன் இலங்கையின் புதிய அரசியல் ஆப்பினுடைய உருவாக்கம் குறித்து நாங்கள் விரிவாக கலந்துரையாடி கொண்டிருக்கிறோம். டாக்டர் டெலஸ், யூ வர் பிஃபோர் த பிரேக் யூ ஆர் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் தி செகண்ட் சேம்பர் ஆஃப் பார்லிமெண்ட். டோன்ட் யூ திங்க் தட் வில் ஃபர்தர் இன்க்ரீஸ் தி இட் வில் பி எ பர்ன் டு த பட்ஜெட்? பிகாஸ் யூ ஹவ் கிரியேட் யூ வில் கிரியேட் அதர் பார்லிமெண்ட் அண்ட் தேர் வில் பி அதர் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் எம்பிஸ் அண்ட் மினிஸ்டர்ஸ்.
Yeah, it will be a burden on the budget, definitely. Any new institution is a burden on the budget. But that is good for democracy. We not only look at the expense, but that contribution that it makes to better governance. So that hasty legislation, the second chamber would be able to have the power to send back for reconsideration. Then the safeguards regarding devolution. So you must not look at it only in terms of the money that we'll spend, right? But
we have a case here that we have so much of people, the alliances of parties get membership in parliament and they become members of the cabinet and then you have state ministers and deputy ministers.
But that is only for this parliament. The constitution is clear on that, that this number exceeding 35 is only for this parliament, and from next parliament it is back to 35 under the present constitution.
But this, who will decide that? You are member of the steering committee of constitutional assembly. What do you really look for? Are you trying to impose the new constitution will have only the views of the political parties, or they
not at all? Already the Public Representations Committee headed by Mr. Lal Vijayanayak had done a very good job from what I hear. All reports from all districts show that people have been very enthusiastically involved in this process. And their report is expected on the 10th of May. They will report on what the people think about the new constitution. And the steering committee of the Constitutional Assembly decided last week to call for more representations from people who did not, and organizations who did not send representations to the Lal Vijayanayaka committee. A number of experts were appointed on Thursday by the Constitutional Assembly. And subcommittees have been appointed. The subcommittees will also call for, when necessary, call for the assistance of experts. And there will be a debate. The debate has already started. So the debate that is going on in the country affects the process.
You're talking about national policies that Sri Lanka should have. Do we have any national policies?
No, I'm only saying this, that in the 13th Amendment, there's a clause which says the center has the power to make national policy on devolved subjects. No, but that is a provision that has been misused. So if you are going to retain that provision, it is, and if national policy and national standards also, national standards for universities or whatever, right, on professions, for example, right? If you want to have national standards and national policies on certain devolved subjects, that must be done with the participation of the provinces. Now, that is the complaint of the provinces. Provinces say, provincial councils say, you make national policy without reference to us. Yeah. And then you impose it on us. That is what I say.
But what I ask is, the neighboring countries, India, whatever party that comes to power, they have national policy in certain areas, foreign policy, the educational policies, and Sri Lanka.
Although they say about India, look, the foreign policy changes from government to government. See, the educational policies, the BJP is trying to, there's much controversy about school curricula. about the imposition of Sanskrit, for example. So you can't always say that there is a clear national policy.
But we don't have one single national policy.
I mean, national policies also change, right? Who decides national policy?
We are in a better position to make national policies because the Sri Lankan parliament has both parties.
Yes, but today, yes. But tomorrow there will be new government and they may want to change the policies because of the experience of the previous national policy. So you can't, I have heard this very much, that we should have national policy which are not, we don't change. That is not possible. National policies are meant to change. But there shouldn't be ad hoc changes.
That's right.
On important issues. That I agree.
But what is going to be, we are talking about new constitution, what is going to be the nature of the state?
Are they
going to stick to the unitary character of the state?
What is important for me is not the label, but the content. Now, if you take the people in the South, most people in the South say that they want a unitary state. You ask them what a unitary state means, they will all say, almost all say, we want an indivisible country. I had this experience back in 1997 or 98 when my own mother was a retired teacher. I was involved in the constitutional reform process, and one day she said, Jampati, why are you involved in this destruction of the unitary state? Eki Rajya Natikarane Ai. Then I asked her, what do you mean by Ekiya Rajya, unitary state? She says, a country that cannot be divided. So the perception, what the Sinhala people want is a country, is a state that cannot be, that is indivisible. Which is different from the traditional meaning of a unitary state in constitutional law terms. Right? So if you ask the people, now I was told when the Public Representations Committee went to the North and East, many Tamil people came and asked for federalism. And when they were asked what they meant by federalism, they said, no, we want to look after our own affairs. So they said they talk about federalism not in the constitutional law sense. Similarly, the Sinhala people say unitary not in the constitutional law sense. In a broader sense, that indivisible country. Tamils want a country, a state where they are also allowed to manage their own local affairs. So this is what must be done. So let us not stick to labels. And say, for example, if the large majority of the Sinhala people want the word unitary, I'm just proposing, yeah. Right? Can we not think of saying unitary here means indivisible? If you say unitary as in the present constitution, there will be problems. Because in the future, Supreme Court will interpret it as a unitary state. But if you want to also safeguard powers given to the provinces, you can have other safeguards. Like, for example, the second chamber must approve constitutional amendments, right? What is important today is the content of devolution, not the labels. So I would prefer to steer clear of this unitary federal debate, because you ask two people, they have different meanings for unitary federal. So best thing is to focus more on the content, like more power, like clear cut division of powers between the center and the provinces. I think the provinces today have a large number of subjects to deal with. Only thing is that they're not clear. The concurrent list has been creating problems. Preferably, the concurrent list should be dealt away with. Most of the powers can go to the provinces. Some of them can go to the center. And in respect of some subjects, the center can legislate and the provinces can administer those subjects. For example, environment, which is a very important area where international standards also come in. But there is no necessity for the center to be giving licenses to petrol sheds and gas stations, you know, in Tissamaram. Surely the provincial council can handle that. But standard can be set at the national level, again with the participation of the provinces, right? So what is needed is a clear-cut division of powers. I think national policy, I've always said, the second chamber. Then these unnecessary powers of the governor.
Okay.
Now the governor has powers which even the Sri Lankan president does not have in the center. For example, the president has no powers over the transfer of officials. It is a matter for the Public Service Commission. Independent, that's an independent Public Service Commission. But whereas the governor in the province has powers, powers are vested with him. There is a provincial Public Service Commission, but he has the power to overrule the decisions of the provincial Public Service Commission. I think firstly we must make the Provincial Public Service Commission an independent one, which is appointed under some criteria. Preferably with the agreement of all parties in the provincial council.
Yeah.
And maybe public service commissions and police service commission, the local provincial commissions, should have some link with the national commissions, right? So that wherever possible, there is uniformity on many matters. I mean, you don't have to have uniformity on all matters, but on crucial matters, there some kind of uniformity will be useful. And take away the powers of this governor. You know, today the president appoints the chief secretary in consultation with the chief minister. But the governor appoints secretaries to provincial ministries without any consultation whatsoever. What is this? This is a joke, right? You have to change this. And I think the criteria that apply to appointment of secretaries and heads of government, heads of departments in the center should be duplicated in the provinces. You can have the same form. And take away the powers of the governor. The governor must be there, of course, as the representative of the center. He must be there. He has an important role to play. But another thing, that the Provincial Councils Act has a provision which says that any statute which has a financial implication must be approved by the governor. Now, every statute has a financial implication. And some governors, not all, in the past, some governors, especially in the North and East, have been using that power to say, no, I won't sign this draft statute until you change some other section, which has nothing to do with
this
finance. But in India, you have the same provision in the Indian Constitution. On a visit to Uttar Pradesh, I asked the Chief Minister, at that time Mayawati was the Chief Minister. I asked the Chief Minister, Secretary, I said, we have this problem there. What is your experience? He said, I have never heard of a governor in an Indian state interfering like that. And they usually allow this draft statute. They leave it to the state legislature body. I think such powers must be taken away. So that will,
basically you say that the governor should be functioning as a coordinator between the state and the province.
Something like that. Also, basically a parliamentary form, Westminster style in the province, but as representative of the president. Now you have governors, you know, going around and, you know, looking after supervising development projects and all that. That is not a matter for the governor. That is a matter for the elected provincial council.
But here we look at, you are talking about various other issues that should be included in the new constitution. One of the big area that is that remains very grey is that, you know, it has Sri Lanka has got international strictures around that, the human rights. And the security sector reforms, even the UN Human Rights Icon has recommended about the security sector reforms and the legal reforms as well as these human rights, bringing into the constitution about the human rights issues. What do you have? Do you have anything?
Yes, I have much to say on that because I was on the drafting team of the 2000 Constitution Bill, which we did under Chandrika Bandaranaike's presidency.
Yeah.
And it included a Bill of Rights with which the UNP at that time agreed. So there is no difficulty. It included, it widened the scope of civil and political rights. Now our present constitution has only civil and political rights. So the 2000 draft widened the scope of civil and political rights, but also brought in social, economic and cultural rights, children's rights and women's rights, which are group rights, which are very important. Then subsequently, I had the occasion to chair a committee appointed by the previous government in 2008, I believe, or 6. We were tasked with preparing a new fundamental rights chapter that accords with Sri Lanka's obligations. Of course, the report was handed over to the government. It never saw the light of the day. It was later published in some website, and thanks to that it is public. We came out with the committee consisted of number of important, I mean, people who have been involved in human rights, like Deepika Audugama, who is chairperson of the Human Rights Committee, just social scientists like Godfrey Gunatilaka, there were others. And we came out with a very strong Bill of Rights. And I would urge I am in the committee, subcommittee on fundamental rights. Oh. It's chaired by Mahinda Samarasinghe, who was the minister in charge of the subject and who gave us a lot of support when we were drafting that bill. So we can look into that. Because
But he is the same minister who defended in the UN that no human rights violations are taking place in Sri Lanka.
Well, that you have to ask him, right? the modern trend is to have social, economic and cultural rights included in the constitution. Women's rights, children's rights. And for us in the left, it's very important to have social economic rights declared as enforceable fundamental rights. And in that regard, I might say, I always mention this that whenever I'm asked about this, look at the constitution of East Timor, Timor-Leste, which is still a least developing country. And it's one of the best bills of rights in the whole of Asia, probably the strongest bill of rights in Asia. Whether the democratic institutions in East Timor are strong enough to sustain that, I don't know. That's a different issue. But our institutions are certainly stronger. So we need to have come out with a new bill of rights.
A new fundamental rights chapter. What about the culture of impunity? That also should be included.
Well,
for the right violators, there's a
good I think what is important now today, it's the jurisdiction of the courts. It's only the Supreme Court that has this power. I would prefer the Court of Appeal sitting in the provinces and giving the Court of Appeal jurisdiction and original jurisdiction to sit in the provinces on fundamental rights. So that the Supreme Court is only an appellate court. And the Human Rights Commission recommendations are not enforced. During the Chandrika Bandaranaike Kumarathunga administration, she issued a circular which required all government institutions to enforce recommendations of the Human Rights Commission. That has now been discontinued. Unfortunately, the courts have also held that is not binding. But we must, I think, in the new constitution consider. Now, if some state organization does not agree with the recommendation of the Human Rights Commission, it is up to that institution to take the matter to court and get it quashed by way of writ of certiorari. Otherwise, they must enforce it. So they can't have it both ways.
Yeah.
They don't move a court against that, but neither do they enforce. I think this has to change so that you make it easier for people to go to complain about violations and get them enforced.
Doctor, we have a lot to discuss. And in another episode, we will probably catch up with the minority rights in the Constitution that is in the making. Thanks for joining us, Doctor.
Okay, thank you very much.
நல்லது நேர்களே, இத்துடன் இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை நிறைவு செய்துள்ளோம். குறிப்பாக இலங்கையிலிருந்து வந்திருக்கக்கூடிய, பிரித்தானியாவுக்கு வந்திருக்கக்கூடிய தேசிய பட்டிய நாடாளுமன்ற உறுப்பினர் டாக்டர் ஜெயபதி விக்ரமரத்ன அவர்களுடன் நாம் இன்று நேர்காணலில் கலந்துரையாடியிருந்தோம். மற்றொரு நிகழ்ச்சி சந்திக்கும் வரை மூட வேண்டும் விடப்பெற்றுக் கொண்டான் பி கருணாகரன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.